Rotman's lab, and where he's a deputy group lead. And we just started talking a few months ago, and I was absolutely impressed by the breadth of his knowledge and the connections between his core disciplines, physics and various social sciences. So he's, as I said, he's a deputy group lead at the Robert Koch Institute and Humboldt University of Berlin at the Lab for Computational Epidemiology. He has PhD in theoretical physics from Humboldt, summa cum laude, with thesis classification of complex networks in spatial, topological, and information theoretic domains. At his current position, he leads this Corona Data Donation Project that he will be talking about today, which is a public health monitoring and citizen project with hundreds of thousands of participants. And he also has a rich experience working in interdisciplinary teams, and he fits right in here because he was working, for example, with social scientists to study the impact of social connectedness on preventive measures during COVID, on social tipping points for climate actions, and otherwise he has papers from complex adaptive networks to ocean atmosphere interactions. And so he's looking for people to collaborate with him on this data set, but also other issues, exploring topics in epidemiology, behavioral psychology, application of test cases for neural methods of time series analysis, machine learning, and many other things. I give you Mark, he's here. Early December.
Exactly.
So I hope you can all get a chance to talk to him.
Yes, I hope so too. So hi, everyone. I'm Mark. I came here last Monday, so I met a couple of you already. It's a pleasure to be here, a very inspiring atmosphere. And I'm super glad that I can be here until December. So there's lots of room to discuss and foster collaboration. So please come and talk to me, or I will come and talk to you. I would like to talk today about a citizen science project that I'm leading together with my boss, Dirk Brockmann, that we started in April 2020 as a novel tool to engage the public in fighting the pandemic. But since then, it has evolved into much more than that. And today, I'm trying to give you a sort of tour de force of what we did in the past 2.5 years. So it's going to be a little bit shallow but broad, but I hope everybody will get a glimpse of the types of questions that we are interested in. I can actually skip this slide almost because Mirta gave such a nice introduction. But yeah, I'm Mark. I'm a Master of Science in Physics. I obtained that one in 2014, so almost 10 years ago, when I worked on opinion formation. So if you're interested in that, please talk to me. It's still kind of a pet project of mine. In 2017, I got my PhD by working on trying to build novel methods for time series analysis that are based on complex networks. And my application of choice back then was the climate. So if you're interested in that, please talk to me too. Afterwards, I did a postdoc for 3 years where I tried to develop or understand social tipping processes for sustainability transformation from a complex network point of view. And then in 2021, right in during the pandemic, I joined the Robert Koch Institute. A few words about our lab in general. So it's Dirk Brockmann's lab. I'm his deputy. We do research on complex systems, and essentially we work on three core topics. The first one is epidemiological modeling. That's essentially what you see up here. The second one is mobility networks analysis, so everything from traffic flows to airline transportation networks, all with the aim of better understanding the spreading of infectious diseases. And the third topic is the one, or the third pillar is the one that I will be talking about today. That's the Corona Data Donation or Data Donation Project, which is, yeah, a participatory citizen science project. Why did we start this project? So it was April 2020, the pandemic hit. And if we all remember how it was back then, we didn't know much. We didn't have testing capabilities. Our reporting system, at least in Germany, was notoriously slow. We didn't really know how bad it's going to be. There were projections, but I mean, so little was known that the Ministry of Health in Germany decided to also work with more exploratory tools, let's say, to understand the pandemic a little better. And the idea is based on a paper which came out that same year by our colleagues from Scripps Research here in the US, where they showed that you can actually use data from wearable devices, so from smartwatches and fitness trackers, to detect influenza-like illnesses. And during the COVID pandemic, especially the first part of it, that was the most prominent influenza-like illness at all. So the influenza itself and any other diseases that caused fever, they were not present at all. So you could really focus on that one. The task was to look at time series of, you know, what you get from your Apple Watch, so your step count and your heart rate over time, and try to find certain anomalous patterns that give you an indication as to whether a person might be sick or not. And the goal was to build a complementary surveillance system for COVID-19. So that's what we tried to do. We set up the Corona Data Donation Project, or other people did that because I only joined in 2021, which is how I call it, a participatory research project. It collects all sorts of vital signals that your smartwatches might collect. So the resting heart rate, the physical activity, your sleep cycles, and so on and so forth. And people decided to give this data to us for public health research. In October 2021, we hit another milestone. I'll talk about this later, when we were also able to conduct some sort of survey in the app that people had to install in order to connect their devices. So we were able to actually interact with the people and get to know a little more about them. In total, we had 1 million users. Many dropped out very quickly, but over 100,000 people stayed with us for more than 2.5 years. So that's quite impressive. 40,000 people, or roughly 40,000 people, took also part in the survey. So we know very much about them. And from all I've seen and heard so far, this is actually one of the largest scientific data set on these types of vital signals worldwide. In December 2022, we ended the data collection. Pandemic was officially over. And we also had to free up some resources because we built the entire infrastructure to process these data by ourselves. We're not the only ones doing that. There's a huge scientific community now that works with these wearable sensors data, which is great for us because we have people that we can share our experiences with, collaborate with, learn from, and of course, we can also test our algorithms against other data sets. Since it's a citizen science project and we needed the people to be engaged and, you know, keep participating and not remove their app from the phones, we decided to engage the people by, you know, starting a science blog. So every month or so, we would put out an article on that blog. We try to keep it short and simple, you know, in order to show the people what we actually do with the data they trust us with. And this is sort of the timeline, you know, of the articles that we put on this blog. There are many more, in total it's over 30, and it's essentially also going to be the outline of this talk. So we will go from left to right and talk about a couple of the applications that we use this data set for. And the first one, it's a so-called fever monitor. That was the original task of the project, to set up a system that allows to track the COVID-19 disease burden in Germany. Not the only one, of course, a complementary one, and by far not the most perfect one, but it was an exploratory project. The idea was, as I was showing in the beginning, to find some anomalous pattern in the data that the people provide us with. We have up here the time series of resting heart rate and the time series of activity for a selected individual. That's of course a perfect example because the signal is rarely so clear. And then essentially we take these two time series and put it in a sort of, you know, vital metric that we can then use to decide whether that person is likely sick or not. It's comparatively simple. You compute a baseline, like a normal heart rate and a normal activity of that person, you z-score it, that's step number two, and then you combine those two z-scores after accounting for some daily patterns that you see in the overall population into this derived metric, and if that metric exceeds a certain threshold, you say, I detect this person as being sick. In the end, you sum up all the detections for each day or for each week, and you get the red curve up here. It's far from perfect, I acknowledge that. Down here is the COVID case numbers in Germany until, I think, June 2022. That's when our system broke down because people became increasingly vaccinated and, you know, the disease took quite a different course. But if you know a little bit about the dynamics in Germany, you see the second wave of infections, the third wave, the fifth wave, and then you go up here to the winter wave in 2020. And if you put the two curves on top of each other, they don't match perfectly, I acknowledge that. But for a system that is basically only derived from like consumer wearable data, I think it works pretty well. Our PhD student Annika is currently writing a paper on it. We're a little behind with that because we had to do the day-to-day work of, you know, pandemic research. But this will be published soon. Like I said, especially in the early phase of the pandemic, when we didn't know too much, yes?
What's the uncertainty in the measuring cases for this data set?
That's a very good question.
You could be doing much better if those are...
Yeah. So they backfilled a lot of the cases. So in the beginning, RKI's, so my institute's system was very slow. So in real time, the uncertainty was huge. They then developed a nowcasting system, which made it a little better. But in the, I would say in the second and third wave, the reporting delay was still a week. So the uncertainty was very, very big. So if we take that data and essentially compare like real time observation of cases with real time observation of what we get, then our system is actually even better than what we see here. Because obviously in hindsight, you know most of the cases, at least the ones that were reported. Still, I would argue that it essentially like the onset, you know, of new waves and also the decline was actually quite well captured. That's why RKR also put it in their situation report, which was quite the honor for us. Yes, Dean.
So when you say detections and cases, I mean, cases are they, when you say cases, these are the ones that were actually tested positive with PCR tests.
Yeah, back then it was only PCR test cases.
Okay, yeah. So the question is, what about all the, if I understand it correctly, you can figure out from the heart rate who has fever and who doesn't have fever. So we know that actually the number of people who are infected, a minority of them actually have fever.
Yes.
So there is a huge, they're not completely asymptomatic.
I see where you're getting with this. Yeah, this is, so you can't compare the actual numbers. So like what we call detections, it's really a qualitative measure. So you would only use it to say, well, something is changing from like 1 week to another or from like 2 weeks prior to today. So something is happening, more people than normal in our cohort have fever. That's what you get from this.
No, but I think it's really brilliant. I like it a lot. And actually in our models, we because we didn't know better, we actually made two groups, the asymptomatic, the ones with fever and the one that we called asymptomatic. Later on, we turned out that, they, of course, they had lots of symptoms, but we didn't know.
Yeah.
It'd be really fun I hadn't thought about you could, anyways, I should be quiet. It's very good.
we can also talk more later because actually we also know now about the symptoms of the people. So we can fine grain this even further. But back then, that's the information we had about the people. Just to wrap it up, we did this like until the end of the project in 2022. We have a project website where you can still see our daily updates. Essentially, the updates are no longer there, but the last state is preserved. And in later waves, obviously, we lost accuracy because, you know, the dynamics of the pandemic was changing quite a lot. I told you that we also know about how people sleep. And the original plan was to also incorporate that sleep data into this monitoring system. It turned out it didn't work too well. So we decided to dig a little deeper as to why that might be the case. And the first thing you do when you want to understand your data is you map it out. And what you get from these devices quite often is the time when people go to bed, the time when they wake up, and then there's a derived measure called the mid-sleep time, that's the midpoint of sleep. And you can see that there's like not at all a homogeneous distribution across the country of Germany, and also not across the US. can see that up here, that's a picture from like a device manufacturer. That those were the only people that could do these types of analyses before. And you can see that in Germany, people sleep very early in the very east, and they sleep comparatively late in the very west. The difference is around 45 minutes, quite roughly. And the difference in sunrise and sunset in Germany is 36 minutes. And it's actually known that especially people that live in the countryside, their sleep cycle is way more synced with sunrise and sunset than people that live in the city. And some people in the audience, like Tom and Jan, they might, for instance, notice this red spot over here. That's Berlin. Down here is Munich. And we have a lot of other major German cities, Hamburg up here, Bremen here, you know, North Rhine-Westphalia, which is quite the dense populated area. So apparently the cities, they deviate from this trend. And our data can show that. Actually, you can do it a little more systematically, you know, and you plot the cities over longitude in purple, and you plot the countryside in gray. It's a little hard to see here on my screen. It looks a little more contrastful. And you can see that this change with latitude, it's quite different. I don't have the actual numbers here now with me. I want to focus on the qualitative shifts. But that's, of course, quite the finding. So you have quite a natural sleep rhythm for people that live in the countryside. You also see that in the US. And quite an unnatural sleep rhythm for people that live in cities. And that's, of course, a huge issue, because unnatural sleep is linked to depression, or heart rate failure, or many other chronic diseases. And at the same time, more and more people move into the city. So we showed this to the Ministry of Health. They were between worried and excited about these results. But I think it's a very valuable insight. And again, something that was not able to be seen before. There were some very expensive and one-off survey studies that showed similar trends. So there's actually a meaningful signal in our data. But at this, you know, resolution, these types of analysis haven't been able before. And I actually think these maps, they look quite impressive. You can actually really see how the sun, you know, moves from east to west in Germany. So now we're moving back to COVID. I want to pitch like two more projects that we are working on to you. We were able to start some in-app surveys in October 2021. That was hugely delayed due to data privacy concerns, so we had to work them all out. But that was a game changer for us, because when we did that, we were able to know when did the people have COVID? What were their symptoms? What's their subjective well-being? What are the experiences they had during the pandemic? So a huge body of additional information, and that allowed us to look even more closely into how the signals of heart rate and steps and sleep change when people contract COVID-19. When you do that, you take the test date, you center all your time series around the date a person had a test, and you average over this like essentially new sense of time, you get these curves. This is the resting heart rate, this is the step count, and this is the sleep duration for people that contracted COVID-19 compared to a negative control group. And you can now really understand the patterns a bit more. So the people get infected, their heart rate elevates even before they take the test or know about the result of the test. Then it dips. We understand that also the body goes to rest. People go to bed, so the heart rate goes back down again. Then it goes back up because the people, they feel healthy and fit again. And then on average, that's of course not for an individual, it takes them up to 60, maybe 80 days to go back to their normal state. So if you get COVID and you want to go and do sports again, maybe keep this number in mind. We're actually also talking to people from sports medicine because they're very interested in these results, and they conduct now similar studies with very wearable devices with their patients. For activity and sleep, you can read the numbers yourself. The activity goes down by a lot. The average activity in Germany per day is 5,000 to 6,000 steps, so it goes almost down to zero when people get sick. They also sleep an hour longer each day just because they stay in bed and rest. But what I think what's interesting is that all the metrics, they actually change even before the people know that they are sick. Now, of course, we do have vaccinations.
But the year zero was the days since COVID test.
Yeah. Someone could feel coming for a week. That's true. Then let's say before the reporting system knows. Okay, that's the correct phrasing. I'm very sorry for that. Of course, this mixes together people that were vaccinated, that were unvaccinated. So we looked even a little deeper because we also know whether people got vaccinated, when they got vaccinated, and which type of vaccination they got. I show you as an example now that we know this, two time series of a person that was unvaccinated and infected, vaccinated and infected. And you can already see here in grays where they approximately took the test. The signals are very strong for the people that were unvaccinated, comparatively weak for the people that were vaccinated. They walked less because they went into isolation. They also slept a bit more because what else could they do when they stay at home? But especially the heart rate peak seemed to go away. So we wanted to look a little deeper in that with a specific focus on the long-term effects of an infection, because by the time we conducted the study, it took us 1.5 years to publish it. The comprehensive studies on this were still comparatively scarce. So now if you go back to these, you know, time series like we've seen them before, we show them a little different here now. Now we have weeks since the test on the x-axis, not the days. That was just because our sample sizes became smaller when we did a further discrimination of the groups. You see in red again the signal that we've seen, huge and drastic changes around an infection with COVID-19. Also quite the long-term effects on average, so up to 12 weeks, people show on average a change in resting heart rate. The same goes for some people that don't go back to their normal activity levels until like 10 to 12 weeks after a test. And also the sleep duration is massively increased. And in purple, you see people that were vaccinated. And I would say it's quite easy to argue that this signal looks much better in a sense that they don't show such a strong response to an infection, on average, of course.
I wonder, is negative people who have taken the test and it's come back negative?
Yes.
So they probably then potentially feel a bit sick.
Yes, that's why you also see like very small dips and changes, because they might have just contracted some other disease. They took a test, but it came back negative. So it was probably just like the common flu or something. Yeah. I'm quickly going to skip over this, but since we did it, we also took a look at what are the frequencies of some form of extreme responses of the body and the behavior to an infection in the immediate weeks, so the 4 weeks after an infection, which is the acute phase. You know, red is again unvaccinated people, purple is vaccinated people, and blue is the negative control group. And we just defined the extremes as they are mentioned here. It's kind of, you know, rule of thumb, but if you play around with these thresholds, 5 BPM per day, resting heart rate increase, 5,000 steps per day, activity decrease, or 1 hour per day, increased sleep, you can also like vary that by a couple of percent. It qualitatively stays the same. You can see that these extreme signals, as expected, they're also much more likely when people were not vaccinated against the disease as compared to when people received at least 2 doses of any COVID vaccination. That essentially brought us then to 2022, or the end of 2022. We ended the data collection. We were able to free up a lot of resources. People were contacting us about our data set, and we had this rich body of survey data. And then myself, I also finally had some more time to look into those. And we collaborate closely with some people in, you know, behavioral psychology and health communication from the University of Erfurt. And they said, well, if you know about people's well-being, why don't you look into that more closely and see how that relates to how people behave? Can we find a link between what we measure about these people? How much do they walk around? How well do they sleep? And how well do they subjectively feel? We know that there must be a link. There's like case studies on that all over. They are survey-based often. They're comparatively small, focus on a specific group, maybe older adults or people in elderly care, for example. But we have this advantage of being able to do it across all the 40,000 people that responded to our surveys. And one specific item or specific method that we use is the so-called WHO5 well-being index. So people were asked every four weeks, we asked them 5 questions. You can read them here. I've been happy and in good spirits. I felt calm and relaxed. I felt energetic and active. I felt fresh and rested when I woke up. And my life has been full of things that interest me. The measure is defined so that you can just average those responses. They are measured on a scale of 1 to 5. You get this time series up here, which is not very informative. The only point this plot is meant to convey is that it's comparatively stable across time. So we're dealing with some sort of stationary system here, which allows us to dissect everything a little further. Now let's bring the two things that we measure together. We know, for instance, about the heart rate of people, we know about their activity, and we know about their well-being that they report, and you can see that there is, surprisingly, I was surprised by that myself, quite a strong linear relationship with almost equal slope for male and female. Male report a slightly higher well-being than females, across the entire range of what we measure. And for the resting heart rate, that's down here, you see a decreasing trend. So essentially those people that have a high step count and a low heart rate, those are like the active people. People that have a low daily step count and a higher heart rate, those are more the inactive people. So these two metrics are quite correlated, but you can in both cases see a very strong monotonic relationship. It's not a causation, of course, but there's a relationship. It also holds across age groups. Older people report a higher well-being. Younger people report a comparatively lower well-being. Maybe that's also an insight, but the general monotonic trend remains. It gets even more interesting when you look at sleep. Now, what I did here is I Z-scored all the well-being measures by age group and gender so that I can make them comparable, because otherwise it just gets a little too noisy. And I plotted out, depending on the average sleep onset of that person or of the people in the past 4 weeks prior to answering to the survey, the offset, the duration of sleep, as well as the mid-sleep point. And we can see, I didn't do a systematic, change point detection yet, but when you put in what is normally considered a healthy sleep schedule, so go to bed before midnight, maybe get up before 7, and sleep around 7.5 hours, then you see that this is where the change in well-being happens. So if you go to bed earlier, get up earlier, and sleep around 7 to 8 hours, then that sort of maximizes what people report in well-being. Again, this is not necessarily a causal relationship. It could be that people feel well and that's why they go to bed early. It could be that they go to bed early and therefore feel well. We don't know, but I think it's a very interesting relationship, especially with that almost constant here and then the sudden drop the later the people shift their sleep schedule. And this, of course, also may have some public health implication. Before I conclude, and then we can discuss about everything that I've shown you, I hope that tour de force was somehow illustrative of the variety of what you can do with this data. I need to talk about the limitations, because obviously the population of people that take part in this is non-representative. That's people that trust the government, because we are the RKI, a federal institute. We don't have any children or teenagers in there, just for data privacy reasons. They can't even participate. We don't have too many old people in there, or at least we have an underrepresentation, so only half of what we would expect from the German population, just because people don't have gadgets. And we have an overrepresentation of, male middle-aged men, which is, of course, always an issue in any scientific research. The data is really messy, so we spend a lot of time on cleaning it up, throwing away all the garbage that was in there. That kept us busy for quite a while. We don't know anything about how the manufacturers measure all these things. Some use light sensors, some use movement sensors, some use a combination. And then you sometimes get figures that look like this. You can plot the average sleep duration, for instance, of Apple users. And then in October, that's always when they announce new products, it drops by 60 minutes just because they changed their algorithm. And we are not informed about that. So we look at the data, we see a signal, and then we figure out whether it's just, you know, an artifact. People might not wear their devices continuously, big issue because battery life is limited. And people even use different devices for different purposes. They have one device for running and one for everyday use, and you somehow need to merge them together or treat them separately. We're still not clear on what's the best procedure here. Just to quickly wrap up, I have a couple of backup slides, but we don't need to go into that. I think we're pretty good on time. What I've shown you is a way to engage the public into, you know, the scientific work and also make transparent how the scientific, you know, work essentially works. So it's not that people are confronted with a paper that they cannot read. We have our blog. We try to make analyses that are understandable to a broad range also of people in the public, to a broad range of, you know, politicians and stakeholders. Everybody has a feeling for step count and sleep, so it's actually very illustrative to use, and that's actually the fun part of it. For us, it just allowed to essentially effortlessly track individual health and public health. Every day we got more data and our results got more clear and better. We were able to frequently interact with the participants. We did a lot of social media outreach. We had, like, you know, a communications team, which was actually just one person, but he did a great job, you know, answering to all the emails. People said, yeah, I saw your figure and, you know, I can find myself in there and things like that. Sometimes they even gave us ideas of what we could look at next, which is pretty cool. And I think, or I hope, that these kinds of participatory tools, then they shouldn't be a gold standard. Of course not. There's clinical trials and randomized trials and everything. But they serve the purpose of probably increasing scientific literacy in the public. So it could be like one building block in, you know, building more bridges between science and society. And I think the COVID-19 pandemic has shown us that there's still some way to go. The beauty is that the data is now sort of in public hands and not only available to the manufacturers. And they've done some research with those data too, or they sell it. That's the two things they do with it. And formerly they were actually very costly to collect. So for us, the cost was €1 per participant per year, which is, I think, pretty, so you get a time series for like €1 per year, which is actually pretty amazing. Once you have the app set up and running, the marginal costs are increasing at like insanely low. I've talked to a lot of politicians. I'm also consulting the federal state of Baden-Württemberg. It's one of the 16 federal states on, you know, ways one could implement these types of tools for other forms of crisis mitigation and public engagement. So we're thinking about infectious disease research, climate change. It's of course a huge topic. One of our collaborators, Kelton Miner, I don't know if you know him, he wrote a very nice paper on the impacts of climate change on human sleep. And he also used this type of data for that purpose. Could show that, you know, with projected climate change, global sleep might become more and more eroded. And you can also work on economic inequality. There's a very nice paper by Tim Althoff where he used activity data to quantify inequality. There's another paper coming out soon from a PhD student in Copenhagen who talked about the mobility burden of motherhood, which I think is also a very nice application because it makes visible certain problems that we might have in our society. If you need further information, you can talk to me. I'm here until December. I'm very happy to discuss all ideas that come to mind, what one could do with this type of data. Maybe it's also interesting for your own research. That would be amazing. Please check out our website, the link's down here. If you type in this link, you get the German page, but you can change the language over here. So it's not the correct URL, I apologize for that, but it's all bilingual. The project on the effects of vaccinations is already published. We also published a second paper where we essentially just plotted out the test results that people essentially submitted. And we could show that this could be a very nice way to deal with underreporting, especially at times when people don't go to official test centers anymore, but they might still enter their positive rapid test into a digital app because that's quick and effortless. And we were able to show that in the US as well as in Germany, in later stages of the pandemic, such a system could actually help to monitor the actual course of the dynamics a little, of the pandemics a little better. This is the team. Like I said, we're just a few people. Dirk's our boss. I'm his postdoc and deputy, and I essentially lead this project now. With Jacob, he's the data engineer who built everything that we needed to analyze this data. So he even went into the server center and installed all the hard drives himself, which was pretty amazing. The first two projects that I showed are mainly in the hands of Annika. She's our PhD student. Katharina from the Complexity Science Hub, so I see Stefan's here. She's collaborating with us. I didn't show her project yet, but she's also working on understanding long COVID a little better using this data. Robert's doing our communications, and Paul's writing his conclusions. With that, I'd like to close for now. If you have further questions, please talk to me. There are a couple of backups, but I'm not going to show them now, but maybe if it comes up. Thank you so much. Oh. Thank you, Lana. Yes, please.
I'm just wondering, you said that there are people dropped out of the study. Did you have to study that data, like the rate at which people dropped out?
Yes. It was almost a constant rate. I don't have a figure that shows that here. And that's
constant rate of drop out. More or less.
I can look it up.
Okay.
I can look it up. I guess a couple thousand per month. Maybe more, because like I said, we started with 1 million. In the beginning, the dropout was very quick, so people took part for 2 days and then they deleted it.
Because I mean, I just wonder, like when someone says, "Go," you know, on January 1st, I'm going to exercise more this year.
Yeah.
What's the rate of dropout for that? Does it match this date kind of day? It seems like there's some sort of universality, I think, of people.
Yeah, yeah. I can look up the actual rate. I guess it's in the end, it was around 5 to 10,000 people a month, because we started with 500,000. In the end, we had 120,000. But that particular effect, we at least try to account for by always measuring each individual's data with respect to the population average on that day. So for instance, when you go on our website, there's a tool, the Explorer, where you can, you know, play around with the time series yourself. And I encourage you to take a look at heart rate, step count, and sleep duration on New Year's. It's very interesting. Because you can also see alcohol intake in that data and the heart rate. You can also see it on Christmas. So at least on the aggregate level, feel free to play around. You can also download this aggregate data for all the 401 federal states and averages for Germany. It's linked on the website. The documentation, because we're a federal institute, is only in German, but it's fairly self-explanatory. I can also walk you through it. But yeah, the dropout rate was fairly constant, and I think it was mostly for two reasons. First, especially iPhones put apps in the background when people don't open them, I think every 30 or 40 days. So then the connection was terminated, or when people bought a new phone. Because again, for data privacy reasons, it was very difficult to transfer one account from one device to another. This is something that if we ever start such a project again, would try to make easier, because there was a lot of frustration from participants who, you know, took part for like 400 days. They bought a new phone and then they couldn't transfer their history, so to speak, over. Yes.
Can you give like a little narrative summary of who owned the data at different points? This, you know, there's like the private industry making devices, there's the people, government, academics. Or how did that all work?
Yeah, so the data, as everybody who has such a device probably knows, is stored on the manufacturer's server. That's where it lives. And the manufacturers, like I said, they can do all kind of things with it. The EU GDPR instead states that this data does not belong to the manufacturer, but it belongs to the individual that, you know, owns the device, whose data it is. the EU GDPR also states that an individual can request a copy of the data and can transfer it somewhere else. That's the right of transferability, I think, some paragraph in the EU GDPR. And that's essentially how our app worked. It made this process of transferring data from the manufacturer's server to our server easy. People could write an email every day requesting a copy of the data and send it to us. You can do that with your Amazon shopping list or shopping cart or whatever. But if you want to do it like every day, that's of course not practical. So our app essentially just built the bridge between the manufacturer and our servers. And the data was never on the people's device. So it got transferred directly from the manufacturer to our server every day. And that was essentially making use of the very strict data privacy regulations that the EU has. So you can also use it to your advantage, so to speak. But that were the only two entities where this data ever lived. And all analysis are done directly in the cloud on our one server where the data is stored, so that nobody needs to download it to a personal machine, because that's, of course, always a data privacy and safety risk. Steen?
So did the manufacturer then make a copy and send it to you, or did they maintain the one?
They keep it.
They did not.
No, for this, of course, you have another right, the right to be forgotten. That's what it's called. You can also send that to the manufacturer, and then they have to delete your data. But this is not what we did here, because obviously the people wanted to keep using their devices and, you know, see their data on Apple Health as well. So it was really a copy.
So if you, before this, asked anyone in medicine or infectious disease, how many days of a cardiac excursion do you have following an infection? Would anyone have said 80 days? I mean, was there any rule of thumb around how long for heart function to fully recover?
There is. So we're talking to, so first of all, we were not the very first one seeing this particular pattern in this type of data. It matches an American cohort, so at least it seems to be comparatively universal. And we work together, or we're like part of a larger consortium that works on long COVID. One member there is a person who does like sports medicine at the university hospital. And he says in sports medicine, the rule of thumb is 90 days. After like any influenza-like illness, you should at least take it very slow for 90 days. And that's approximately what we see here too. So he was actually pretty excited because it helps him make his case. But as it often is in medical research, you have, you know, small clinical trials. You cannot essentially transfer the insight from one cohort to another. So there might be cohorts where it's much quicker. There might also be cohorts where it's much longer. It's also hugely dependent on age. We didn't look at that in too much detail, but that's known. But 90 days is a rule of thumb if you don't know how you should behave. Yes?
I'd like to ask you about something you didn't talk about today, but I guess that you talked about network dynamics.
Uh-huh.
Like, well-being is a network property.
That's true.
People's well-being affects others. And obviously they're being infected by other people.
That's true.
So infection and symptoms are a network property as well.
Yeah.
So can you talk about that and how you think that might relate, or what types of questions you might be interested in answering that have that network dynamics, since that's something you're interested in?
Yeah, that's actually true. I haven't thought about this in full. I have told you that I personally have worked on trying to find new methods for data analysis that use complex networks. They are mostly based on computing similarities between, you know, different types of entities. So for instance, similarity between people for which we know how they behave and for which we know how they feel. So we could try and bring these two aspects together, you know, finding groups that behave similar in terms of their sleeping patterns, of their activity profile, and also behave similar in terms of how well they think they are doing, because that's exactly what well-being measures. I haven't looked too much into that. What I would really like to do, but we can't because we didn't build it in the beginning, is track people's contacts. That would have been really cool. There was in Germany a contact tracing app, and I think it was possible for people to also donate their contacts. Few people did, and they only donated how many contacts they had, again, for data privacy reason, not with which other user. But having this information would be amazing, you know? So knowing who, and there is like, I think, 100,000 people, or not 100,000, a couple thousand people at least from Berlin. So there is a fair chance that they meet every now and then. And having that information, of course, would be great, but we don't have, unfortunately. Yes.
Just to follow up on that, what kind of, do you have any high frequency geolocation data that you could?
No, we do have, and that's what Katharina, our visitor, is doing. We do have high frequency data on sleep and activity and heart rate down to seconds, which is pretty amazing. But of course, that also doesn't allow you to infer any like inter-individual contact behavior or anything like that. But it allows you to see even better whether a person actually did exercise or went for a hike or just walks around a lot every day. Those people, of course, also exist. Yeah.
So for the people that were sort of had weak symptoms, did you think about how, okay, could you use some of these signals you have to infer whether people they were still infected but did not have fever? See it on I don't know, is there a change in patterns?
Yeah, there is. I don't know if I have the figure with me or our student, but I can request it. And there's going to be another blog article soon because we keep updating the blog. We looked at the number of symptoms that people report versus the change in resting heart rate, just as a first proxy, you know, as to how that scales. And for most parts, so if you exclude only one symptoms and people with 10 or more, it's a linear relationship. So with every additional symptom, on average, the heart rate during the acute phase, or I think even only the first week of being sick, increases linearly. So it's a very clear. I can request a figure and show it to you if I don't have it myself.
Yeah. Okay.
But yeah.
Nita. Is there on the website, or can you tell us a bit more what else was in the survey? You say it was well-being, the symptoms, the socio-demographics.
Yeah, I can send you a list. It's very, I mean, we don't have it on the website. We could put it up there, but for various reasons, I've compiled a list. So it's just in short, it's a lot of socio-demographics. It's basically any information you could wish for about what people experienced in the acute phase, so the symptoms, whether they had to go to hospital, all these things. We have 5 different well-being items, so WHO5, SF12, and EQ5D. And we have all the items from what is called the German COSMOS study. I don't know if you're aware of this one. That was focused on how people behave and how they experience the pandemic. So questions like, did you avoid parties yesterday? How many people were you in contact with? Things like that. How do you think the government handles the pandemic? All these types of questions, but I can give you a list.
Oh.
Jan, please.
Yes, one could imagine that in the future, policymakers, health officials would want to use those data real time.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something that is anticipated? And how do you anticipate that?
You could, in theory, do it real time, because you can send as many requests for data transfer to the manufacturers as you want. I mean, they can't do too much about it, I would say, once you at least negotiate some terms with them. So let's say you can do near real time, because I think a request once every hour is fairly reasonable, but that request is also the costly part, because that's when the data transfer happens, and that's when your server needs to be active. And if you want to make a request for 100,000 people, like, of course, it's just like in the millisecond, but it quickly adds up. So and this is also why we regularly tried to remove users that are no longer providing data for various reasons. So because we just had, you know, we knew there was a connection once, and then, you know, our server tried every day to get the data, even though no new data was coming in, and that's the costly part. So that's the trade-off, essentially. So we did it once every day. So if you do it every hour, the cost doesn't go up by 24, but by quite the large number. I was surprised myself because I always thought other parts of that would be the expensive bit, but it's actually making the request.
Right. If there are no more questions, thank you very much. Mark is here.
Thank you.